David, you highlighted the key races you're watching. What else are you looking at heading into tomorrow? Particularly, I'm thinking about the Trump factor.
Yeah, I mean, tomorrow's going to be interesting. You know, these are usually low turnout elections, but we heard Ben Dworkin in our piece there say that the Republicans are trying to nationalize this election while the Democrats are trying to localize it. So, yeah, who turns out tomorrow? Is it, in fact, the base of the parties? And then what do the results say about the state of mind of the bases, right? Are the Democrats so far left they're in the progressive AOC camp that only those folks are going to turn out and the moderates are going to sit this one out? On the Republican side, is Trump the big factor here? And will he create upsets in some of these closer races? I think that's the thing we want to look for.
Yeah, Colleen, as David mentioned, historically low turnout when it comes to these primary races. What do we expect? We've got early voting happening for the first time here. What can you tell us? I know you've been working all day to gather some numbers.
Yeah, last time, and we should really look at 2018 because that was the last midterm election when Congress was at the top of the ticket. Last time we had 20% of the registered Democrats and Republicans went out. 706,000 people. Now, independents or unaffiliated voters can vote if they declare a party at the polls, but the vast majority don't. So far, we have had 266,000 people vote either by mail or early in person, and the vast majority is by mail. Only about 20,000 people voted early in person. I'm one of them. See, I got my sticker. Voted yesterday. Was easy, quick, no lines, which, you know, kind of isn't a good thing. But the 266,000 we're talking about then represent about 38% of all those who voted 4 years ago. Now, as for whether some of these folks wouldn't have voted if this wasn't available, we don't know. It'll be interesting to see how many people actually go to the polls tomorrow.
Well, and I do wonder, David, how much the issues like gun violence, like the leaked Supreme Court decision on Roe v. Wade, may push voters that maybe would have stayed home.
Yeah, I mean, that's going to be a really good question. Those are really, you hit them right on the head, the overriding issues in this race for Democrats and Republicans. Whether or not those things really resonate in New Jersey, we'll have to see, because New Jersey has, as you know, some of the strictest gun laws in the country and some of the most liberal abortion rights laws in the country. So will those motivate voters who are now supercharged because of the leak at the Supreme Court and some of the mass shootings that have taken place over the past 2 weeks? Will that bring people out? And who will that bring out? Will it bring out moderates who are looking for more gun control? Or will it bring out more of the extreme parts of the party on the Republican side who want this party to be much more Trump?
Colleen, how much does the new congressional map factor in?
So, you know, in terms of the primary, it factors in a little bit because we have seen some races shift. Some folks, in fact, were going to run in one district and chose to run in a different one because of the way the map was drafted. But mostly it's going to make a difference in November. We've seen the Democrats shore up some support, theoretically anyway, in the 3rd district, the 5th and the 11th. Where they had, you know, slimmer majorities before. But on the other hand, the 7th district where Tom Malinowski is, that district has gotten more Republicans. So that should be a big factor in November.
And of course, you both will be covering it all for us tomorrow and in November. Colleen O'Day, David Cruz, thanks for your time today.
Thank you, Bree.
Right.